sweet harmony. Go on and blow on, stay in perfect tune through your unfamiliar song. Make the world aware that you're still going strong. Your joy around the world. Spread your joy around the world. Sweet harmony, yeah. Go on and blow on. I believe
welcome, everyone, to another edition of Community in Depth. This show is very special to me because we have on the phone with us our friend Mitch Carmody. Many of you know Mitch as the host of Grief Chat, which is a show that we have on KDWA once a month. He's a Prescott resident, a former resident of outside of Hastings, and he is here today to talk about something that he's been in the news about personally. We're going to talk a little bit about social injustice. So first of all, Mitch, always so nice to chat with you, and I'm grateful that you called in today.
Oh, thank you, Mo, and thank you for the special invite on this topic today, because I think it's on everybody's minds during the COVID that, we're having a lot more people are really, soul-searching themselves, I think, in a time of this country has never seen before.
So, Mitch, what we really want to talk about first is you and your family had a nice gift that you gave. And do you want to tell people about that and maybe some background of that, please?
Yes, I will. Because, just recently, my stepfather died at age 96. And he was my, my mom was his third wife. And they, he lived a long time. So when we went through all the things that we inherited from after his death and going through some things, and my mother had died, almost 20 years ago now, and he got remarried and whatnot. But in that, when my mom had died, he gave me a bunch of stuff, that my mom had. And my mom, there was one envelope that my mom had written, to give to Mickey. That's what she called me. And it was my grandfather's had six cemetery plots that he had purchased in 1929 at Sunset Memorial in Minneapolis. So, I've always had those. And I, 10 years ago, I thought, well, no one really wants them. Our family, my grandparents weren't buried there. My mother, we're not really a cemetery family, but we have these plots. And so, my son is, his ashes are in Hawaii, and my twin sisters are, I'm not even sure where, because we were not in charge of that, her husband was. And so, because it's not that important in our family, we still have these six plots from 1929. And so I tried to sell them about 10 years ago or put them on, but it's really kind of a very tough to market them or put them on eBay or Craigslist or something. And so I eventually just gave up because no one really responded. And they're probably worth about $1,500 a piece. And I mean, they're right in the brand when it was built and right in the center of Sunset Memorial. So they're a prime location and beautiful lot. I went talking to my sisters about what should we do with these plots? And then George Floyd was murdered in Minneapolis. And it affected everybody and affected the whole world. We started thinking that, I looked at these cemetery plots and there's an Amendment 8 on the cemetery plot deed signed in 1929 that said interment of individuals only of the Caucasian race to be interred in Sunset Memorial. I was kind of shocked and looked at it. My mother had underlined it or something, so I noticed it and wow, that is really bizarre. And so I thought, well, maybe it would be a nice thing to do, my sisters and I talked, that we, you know, because of all what happened in Minneapolis and Philando Castile too, and that maybe we should donate these plots to a family of color that was affected by the riots or it was in need. But we thought it might be good poetic justice to do that. But we didn't really know who to connect. So I called my friend Ruben Rosario. I know you're familiar with Ruben Rosario.
He writes for the Pioneer Press. Yes.
Right. For 30, 40 years. It's a long time. And then about 5-6 years ago, he was diagnosed with cancer and was really challenged by that. And I talked to him. He'd done a couple articles, one me, a Hastings man, when I wrote my book, and then another article a few years ago when I went across the country on a tour. And so I called him. I said, Ruben, I know you're retired. You've been challenged with cancer, and now Denise finally retired. And he said, well, I am retired, but I will come out of retirement for special cases. And, well, I'm not looking for an article, Eric. I just thought, with your connections, I thought I saw an article a few years ago about a Brooks funeral home in St. Paul that had donated or helped the Philando Castile family and when he had been shot. So he connected back to me. He said, oh, yes. He goes, the Brooks funeral home in St. Paul is one of the oldest black-owned funeral homes in the state. So he said, would you like me to contact them? And I said, yeah, that would be great. We just really would like to see these go into good hands. And the owner of Margaret Brooks called our family and talked to my sister and said she was she was in tears. She was so, so grateful and so surprised and indebted and just was, she was just so excited. And so we did all the paperwork and transferred them over to the Margaret Brooks Funeral Home to be used at their discretion. It was just, it really felt, right now I think we're falling behind, I think, in where we are in social justice. And so it's the little people, it's us at the ground level that can make a difference. And rules and regulations and laws will be changed and made, but it's really what we've grown up with in our family that we're learning, it's a different world than we grew up in. And just our family wants to make a difference now, how we can, when we can.
And obviously that clause is no longer in the Sunset Memorial
What was very interesting with Ruben, the excellent journalist that he is, found out that it was actually challenged by a couple that was going to be buried there. They had bought their plots. They had signed the same contract, but it's a small clause, so they may not have even seen it. But it was a man, and his wife was Native American. And she died, and she would not be permitted to be buried in Sunset Memorial. This is like in 1961 because she was Native American. The man was just, oh my God, this can't be happening. And he went to the court lawyers, and it went to the Supreme Court, and it was overturned and overruled in 1961 because of that. But in 1961, in our state, Minnesota, that is so proud of its indigenous peoples, to have that happen was egregious. And so I'm happy that we were able to have changed back then, and also to keep move forward in that kind of tone to be able to help our communities in a more equitable way.
So Mitch, I know also that you really have a focus on social injustice over the years, and that's something that you didn't necessarily grow up with.
I grew up with actual passive racism. We didn't know our parents or grandparents were racist, or if they were called that. They weren't even used, that term wasn't even used. You were prejudiced or you were biased, or we didn't really have a definition because it was so mainstream. But because we grew up, I grew up born in 1955. That, 1954 was the Civil Rights Movement. Civil Rights Act didn't come until 1964. And, I was 10 years old. And so growing up all that time, Christmas time, we'd have Thanksgiving, we'd have the bowl full of nuts on the table, and the great big Brazil nuts were not called Brazil nuts. They were called N-toes. And, that's all I ever heard. I didn't know until I was an adult, into my 30s, that I didn't know what they were called, because we always called them N-toes. And not knowing, we were racist, we were kids, but that's what they were called. Or the little licorice babies that were like the texture of gummy bears were little licorice black babies, and they were called N babies, and everybody said it, wasn't thought about, and people told racist jokes and back and forth, or you jerry-rig something, you n-rigged it. That was the vernacular. That was of the day. And so no one really thought much of it until I got older. My dad died when I was 15. And so, you know, a lot of this is grief related too, you know, because, you know, you're raised with what you have, what you're taught. And then when I was 15, we were also, the social consciousness was changing in the 70s. And so when my father died, and he was a police officer, and I had all the respect for him. But after he died, I had to get a job. And I went to the Hilton Hotel in St. Paul. When I turned 16, I applied. I got a job, bought a $200 Chevy. And I drove to the levee. I drove my Chevy to the levee every day in St. Paul and parked and worked at the hotel, afternoon shift, 40 hours a week, while I went to high school to finish high school. Mm. And there was such an awakening to me, because I worked with so many different people of ethnic origin at the hotel, that, you know, I had a black kid that worked next to me. He got hired around the same time, you know, and we'd be washing dishes and we'd yell back and forth, slang, epitaphs toward each other, just because we were kids and could get away with it, but knowing we heard this stuff at home, and, you know, and then started really more. There was Philippine, I learned Tagalog, there was Russians, I learned Russian, Native American, I learned Dakota, you know, I learned so many people. And there was that young kid that I worked with, and I had to give him a ride home one night. And I'm 17 years old, and he said, can you give me a ride home? And I said, yeah. And so he said, where do you live? And he said, up near Selby Dale. You know, and my heart just kind of stopped, because when we were kids, you know, if you went up near Selby Dale, my dad says, lock your doors, roll up the windows. You know, we're in the ghetto. And so I had to give him a ride home at night after, at, you know, 11 o'clock at night, and going into Selby Dale. My heart was racing. And I go in and pull up, and Lester and I get out of the car, and he said, come on in for a minute. You know, like, my mom and dad are still up, and I want to thank you for giving me a ride home. And so I went in and welcomed me and everything, and saw their house. And I said, oh, my God, this house looks so normal, except all the pictures on the wall are of black people. And I said, but why did my mom paint it, or our society paint them a group of people as being so scary, you know? And that went on through, you know, through high school into college. And you didn't go to the certain part of Minneapolis because the Native Americans were there. You don't go there at night. You didn't go into different parts of University Avenue, or you stay away from areas. And we just kind of took that for granted. And it just, I think, all comes from a socioeconomic system since the end of the Civil War, you know, where there was a lot of white supremacy. And when civil rights were overturned, a lot of things went underground, and Jim Crow went underground. And so it's a very subtle thing that it's in our society. That we just don't know until we know. We don't know we're saying a racist thing until we do. But when you recognize that it's wrong, recognize that, well, you know, we don't say those. We don't call Brazil nuts that anymore. It's just not right. But there's some people that still choose to use that vernacular in their everyday talking, and don't think it's anything's wrong with it. But there's a difference in waking up, you know, a person of color in the morning, knowing you have to armor up for the day for what's going to assault you, because it's so subtle. I've been speaking in grief for 30 years across this country, and going to all different. And when in that grief, there's no color in grief. Grief is a broken heart, and I don't see color at all. But there are some that do in different parts of the country. There's people that do things differently because of race. And so it's very intriguing that we've come to a point in our society now that we can do something about it. And I think with the recent things in the news, with unjust killings that are perpetrated against people of color, that it's time to really assess where we're at, I think.
Mitch, do you think you can raise a child that does not see color? And then I've heard other people say to me, that's racist if you say you don't see color.
Right. And I can say, like, you know, with my grandchildren, like I said, like my grandchildren have been raised with, I call it, you know, proactive grieving. So they know the proactive grieving part of it. We've discussed many times. They know that that is a part of life, that you die, and then you live and you die, and that maybe we can connect with them across the veil in heaven. So they've grown up with that, and that's what they understand and get. And they've also grown up with social justice. and that they don't hear those words in our house, though they still hear them in the community. And my granddaughters don't seem to, they don't use those words at all, of course, and seem very conscious of what to say. But yes, saying you don't see color is it's all wordsmithing, how we say it. You know, we used to not be able to say colored people, and that was bad. I mean, I grew up or Negro, my college buddies, when I went to college, said, you don't say Negro and you don't say colored people and you don't say Indian. You say Native American, you say person of color. You know, so we change through the years, we change what we say, but you're damned if you do and damned if you don't sometimes on how you pronounce something or say it. But it is changing. So it's hard not to be, it's obvious. Yes, people are black and people are brown. And that's part because of culture. They wear African stuff from Africa and proud of their heritage, or the Hmongs wear their festivals in St. Paul. I mean, our whole community, we got used to having a Hmong population, which we have no idea existed. And yet we had some, from the Vietnam War, there's probably some apprehension about people moving into our area that they had once, in a country that they, not exactly the same country, but, people are generalized by the color of their face or their look of their eyes. And so there's still some of that. But I think that the Hmong people in Minnesota really prove what synergy and how you can work with each other. And so I'm really proud of the Twin Cities, actually, for what it has done in many different ways. And backtracking with the Lakota, I mean, the hangings in Mankato and of Native Americans was horrendous, how the Native Americans were treated. And sometimes the ghetto areas were set up almost like reservations. Well, let's put them in their certain area. But it was not uncommon back in the day when you had Swede Hollow and we had the Italians up on Payne Avenue and, everybody went to their own area because they spoke the same language, they went to the same churches, they did the same festivals, and it was kind of a voluntary segregation, but when it started to become more mainstream, that we started seeing more and more people of color being, not as getting as many opportunities. And so that's what I want to speak is that, to have my children, my grandchildren grow up. And I have several relatives that are biracial. And I've talked to them. And yes, there's a fear that they walk out there that say something to them. Or even someone is walking into a parking lot and hear everybody start slamming, locking their car doors when you walk by. And, as a Caucasian on the street, you probably don't hear that. But that's other people are faced with that. So I think it is getting better. I think children are growing up, especially with what's going on in the news now and all the talk and social injustice and white privilege is talked about. And not everybody agrees, obviously. But the dialogue is out there. And that's what's important, that our children in the future can make a decision on their own, not from what their grandparents said or even their parents said, but what's happening now and what makes sense and what is right.
We appreciate that, and we appreciate your insights, Mitch. Thank you so much.